What's going on, everybody? Hey, welcome to, I think, our very first edition of Youth Pastor Devotions, a time where we just get together, a couple of youth pastors, and we chat about a couple things. So I'm going to let these guys introduce themselves. Many of you might already know them. If you don't, this is an opportunity to kind of get to know us really quick. Then each of us are going to share a 3 to 4 minute devotional. It's not anything but to give Jesus glory and to build up the church, not just one church, because you'll see there's more than just one youth pastor on here. Multiple youth pastors and youth ministries are represented. So this is all about connecting with you, connecting with each other, and building a community of like-minded Christians so that when you're in your school, when you get back to school, or maybe you're at the beach or you're hanging out, you see another youth pastor or another youth group and you know them even better because we've been taking time to develop relationships. So that's what this is all about, just a devotional time. We want to get something and we believe it'll inspire you. So we'll start with Nathan first and then Caleb, and then we'll kick off the devotion. Go ahead.
All right. My name's Nate. I'm from Christ Walk Church here on Fernandina Beach, the Amelia Island. I'm the family ministry pastor here, so I oversee Christ Walk Youth. Shout out to my Christ Walk Youth family if you're watching this, and you should be. We'll raise the roof. But yeah, so my role here is that, and I love seeing the next generation come to know Jesus.
Awesome.
Awesome. My name is Caleb Marsh. I have the incredible opportunity to serve the youth and next generation and lead them here at Celebration Church in Amelia Island. So I'm so thankful to be under such great covering of Celebration Church. And I'm just thankful for the opportunity to be a part of something special and to be a part of serving our community alongside you guys.
That's fantastic. And I'll finally introduce myself. I'm Tommy Peters. I'm the next gen also pastor at the Journey Church. I oversee youth, middle school, high school, and I help with the kids programs as well and what we do. And it's an honor and privilege to do it at our church, and it's an honor and privilege to do this along with guys like you, who I know love Jesus just as much as me, and you're on fire for Christ and you want to see your students grow. So Nate's going to kick off our devotional time. So Nate, go ahead, kick us off and tell us what God's got on your heart.
Sure. So I've been thinking about this particular season, especially as it relates in the context of students, and really this applies to everybody. But you know, we're dealing with a situation where it can feel very easily like the world's kind of caving in around us. And it's kind of like it reminded me of the difference between a mountain and a molehill. And you've probably heard at some point or another, somebody's probably said to you that you shouldn't make a mountain out of a molehill. But the truth of the matter is that the gravity of a certain situation is really often based on the perception of the person who's receiving that. That's good. Whatever the situation is that they're going through. And so what might seem like a molehill to somebody else is a mountain to the person who's dealing with the situation that they're in. And in this season in particular, I'm reminded that we're all dealing with the same exact situation, the same exact problem in real time, but we might be experiencing different repercussions of that problem. Now, generally speaking, when it comes to me, I'm a worrier. I like to worry about everything, and this season during quarantine has really been no different. But I know that scripture tells me not to worry, and yet I still choose to worry for some reason. I guess it's just part of my nature. And over the last year, the Lord's really liked, helped me walk through that anxiety and that worry that I feel when something doesn't go or something that's out of my control. And so he's kind of been teaching me some things, but I wanted to make note of just something that the Lord spoke to me very, very recently. And it was this, it's that no matter what you're going through, it's not a matter of minimizing the problem that you're experiencing. It's not a matter of minimizing the thing that you're walking through. It's really just a matter of magnifying the one who's ultimately in control. And so we can choose to magnify the Lord despite our situation, despite our circumstance. We put on spiritual glasses and we put on the lens of the Holy Spirit, and we look through scripture into all of the world despite our circumstance, and we can magnify God despite what's happening around us. And so it reminded me of the Apostle Paul when he's writing to the church at Philippi, and he's in prison at this point. And what's around him doesn't match quite what he's experiencing. And it reminds me of the fact that even though he's in a season where it could look like a mountain versus a molehill, he's choosing to magnify God. He's choosing to rejoice in the fact that God even has him in prison for a particular reason, to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ. And ultimately, he points us to the fact that there's still, the best days are still yet ahead of us. And I think that's what our students need to understand, mm-hmm. is that even though we're in a season of isolation, we're in a season of quarantine, we're in a season where everything feels like it's caving in around us, the best days are still ahead of us. And scripture is very clear about that. Even Paul is clear about that. You know, he uses certain wording in Philippians 1 when he's talking about the best days being ahead. And he uses this terminology that talks about being free. And like, people debate on whether or not what he's saying as being free is being free from prison or being free and that ultimately he's going to experience eternity with God because of the cross of Christ. Mm. And ultimately, you know, that what Paul's wish is and what our wish should be is that Christ would be honored through our lives despite what's going on around us. And so my prayer lately has been for students is, it might seem like a mountain, but in the lens, through the lens of the Holy Spirit, through the lens of God, it's just a molehill. And that despite what we might be going through, we can still honor God. We can still honor God through what we're going through if we will just magnify him in the season that we're in. So whatever we're facing, if you're watching this today, whatever you're facing, whether it be because of the pandemic that we're currently in, or maybe it's just in spite of the pandemic and something's going on in your life personally, I want to encourage you that you've got to be bold, full of courage, just like Paul in prison. Because of Christ, your best days are still ahead. And a mountain's not a mountain when we magnify the one who's in control. Man. So that's what I would tell our students today.
That's great. That's great. Oh, man, Caleb, what you got for us? That was fantastic, by the way. That was really good. Encourage me.
Absolutely. Thank you so much for that, Nate. I think we all find ourselves, not just you, in situations of worry and anxiety, despite what the truth of this tells us. You know, we acknowledge the truth of the word, but applying it to our own life is something different sometimes. So we have to walk through those seasons and those trials of, man, how do I process worry? How do I process anxiety? How do I process just reality sometimes? So that was super encouraging. A lot of things that the Lord has been speaking to me, not only for our students, but for me personally, is just what this season of waiting looks like. If you're like me, I feel like we're waiting on so many things to happen right now. We're waiting for normalcy to happen, for our church doors to open. We're waiting for certain businesses to open back up, our favorite restaurant. I know a lot of people are excited that the gyms finally opened this week here in the state of Florida. We've been waiting on so many things to happen. I'm waiting on pro sports to come back. LeBron's going to win another title this year. Like, there's a lot of things we're waiting on, right? And I began to process this idea of, well, what should we do while we're waiting? And I was reminded of a situation, and maybe you guys have been here before, and the students, I know you've certainly been here before, where you're like waiting in line, but all your friends have already sitting down, whether it's a restaurant or it's at the lunchroom or something like that. And I remembered a specific time where my friends were all going out to eat and I was still in line for like a long time, like another 15, 20 minutes while they were eating. And I just remember this overwhelming feeling come over me while I was waiting that I was missing out on something. I could hear my friends laughing. They're having a good time telling stories, telling my jokes, and I wasn't even there. You know what I mean? And I just was so overwhelmed with this, I don't know, this feeling, this FOMO, like I was missing out on something. And I believe in this season, that's what a lot of us are walking through. We're missing out on what our senior year looks like if we're a student. We may be missing out on, you know, whatever this season has to bring us. There's a lot of different things that I think a lot of us may feel, honestly, if we're speaking truthfully, like we're missing out on right now. And I was reminded of a story in the Bible of King David. Everyone knows David. You know, he goes on to defeat Goliath. He goes on to be, you know, the psalmist who writes the book of Psalms and tells us so many promises and things from God's word. But what a lot of people don't recognize is that David was anointed a king at a young age, a teenager. He's 12, 13 years old is what most scholars say. And he actually waited about 15 years before he ever became the king of anything. He was the king of Judah after 15 years and even longer to become the king of Israel. And I thought about that moment. I said, David was promised a position of a throne at a very young age, but he had to endure a long waiting season. Like, I've never waited on anything for 15 years in my entire life, you know? And he had to endure a long waiting season of something he was promised. And you may think, why did God do that? Was it just, you know, out of spite? Did David mess up? Did he do something bad? And of course, David had his ups and downs, but I truly believe God was molding him during that waiting season. God was building a character within him. He was building a heart within him. He was building that man that we know as David, that was always repentant, that was always seeking God's face. He was the man after God's own heart. That didn't come when he was on the throne. That came during the waiting season. And I began to ask myself this question, and I asked my students as well, what is God teaching you during this season? God taught David a number of things. That's when David defeated Goliath. It's when David had to learn to listen to the voice of God. He had to learn what obedience and disobedience looked like. Some things he had to learn the hard way during that season. And I believe if we just try to get through this season of waiting as fast as we can, we're going to miss out on a lot of things. We're going to miss out on things that we may never learn in other times of life because it's never looked like this before. Mm. Things are going to ramp up. They're going to get busy again. We're going to go back to school. We're going to go back to work. And we're going to make excuses to not sit and rest in God's presence and learn what he's trying to teach us, honestly. So I find myself time and time again saying, God, what are you teaching me while we're waiting? What are habits? What are things that I haven't been doing? What are obstacles that I haven't faced yet? What are things are you showing me right now that I need to learn to continue on to what you have for me in the future? I believe if David didn't have to wait during those 15 years, we may not call him a man after God's own heart like we do right now. Mm-hmm. We know that he had his ups and downs and he messed up. And who knows, maybe he would have never recovered from one of those times. Maybe he would have never sought God's face and asked for repentance one of those times. There's some things that God taught him during that trial and season of waiting, that period of endurance that he had to build that made him the man that he became. So that's simply what God's been teaching me and showing me, is that there's purpose in every season of waiting. So don't try to bypass it so quickly and just try to waste it and let it go away so quickly. I find myself scrolling for minutes at a time. And I thought, man, are we just scrolling away this season? Are we just scrolling away, Netflixing away, TikToking away this season and not asking God, what are you trying to teach me right now? So that's what I've been learning, man.
And that is phenomenal. I love that. In fact, it's like the Holy Spirit knew that then we were having the same conversation in our own hearts and minds. You were thinking about this, and then God was putting something very similar in my heart. And just to pull back the curtain, the only conversation we have had amongst us youth pastors is a texting conversation. Hey, what do you want to share? And what you just shared and what I'm sharing ties together and even just builds off what Nate was saying on magnifying God. So I'll just jump right into it. That whole idea of being separated from your friends at the lunchroom and they were all telling jokes and you were like there by yourself. I can completely relate to that. Like, I hate being left out. And I know students have that. We all struggle, not just students, but adults. And so I think during this season, there's this deep sense of separation anxiety. There's this deep sense we've been separated from our friends. Obviously not virtually. I know we still have our phones, right? Like you said, we find ourselves scrolling through TikTok and you realize it's been 30 minutes, right? Like, we can virtually see our friends and do things. But here's the reality is physically we've been separated from our friends, our families, our church, our routines, our sports teams, maybe just from people in general that you normally hang out with. And this separation brings a great sense of loss and being disconnected. And these feelings create a reality, and this reality, I'm sorry, of separation can often shape and form how we view others and really how we view God. Because I think you were sharing a lot from like viewing other people, like how this is like affecting you and what God wants to teach you. But I think often it can shape, if we're not careful, how we even see and perceive God. Because maybe if we're feeling separated from others, maybe we feel separated from God, yeah. Right? Maybe we're really feeling like God is far off. Everyone else is like physically distant, maybe God's distant too. I don't know if you struggle with that, but I personally have been dealing with that massively. We create this world in our hearts and our minds that make us believe we aren't really connected to God, and maybe he's separated from us just like everybody else. And then God brought me to one of my favorite scriptures in Romans chapter 8, 35, 37 through 39. Just listen along. If you want, you can read it later. Can anything separate? There's that word. Can anything separate us from God's love? Does it mean he no longer loves us if we have trouble or calamity or are persecuted or hungry or destitute or in danger or threatened of death? I mean, sometimes I just feel like there's this threat of COVID and death, right? No, despite all these things, we're overwhelming victory is ours through Christ Jesus who loved us. And I am convinced that nothing can separate us from the love of God, neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the power of hell or the fears of today or the worries of tomorrow. There's so much fear about what's going to happen tomorrow, but God's love doesn't change. There's that word separate. Keep saying separate is nothing can separate us from the love of God. No power in the sky above nor the earth below. Indeed, nothing in all creation is able to separate us from the love of God that is revealed in Christ Jesus our Lord. See, the Bible reassures us that nothing changes God's love. He always chooses us, considers us, and always unconditionally is devoted to us. So sometimes, I don't know about you, listener, viewer, whoever you are today, I don't know about you, but sometimes I need to be reminded of the truth of God's word. And it really, the truth of God will change ultimately how I feel and perceive the world around me. God's truth, the word of God, can really shape. And the truth of God's love, really, the truth of God's love ultimately shapes who God truly is and who he can be for us and who he ultimately is. Because God is love. And so that alone can shift everything in our hearts and our minds, if we stay grounded in that and reassured. When I just read that today, this morning, I was like, man, I am reassured that nothing changes because of God's love. Like his love for me doesn't change. And so I am steadfast in my emotions. I'm steadfast in my mind. When I feel like I'm separated from everybody, I know that I'm not separated from God. And that is something that we need probably more than anything in this moment, is to be reassured of our relationship with him isn't changed because of our conditions. He's an unconditional, loving God, and he's always there. That's what encouraged me today.
Absolutely. And I love that you just mentioned the fact that God is unchanging despite the circumstances, despite what we're looking at. I've heard it more so recently, and it's just so exciting to know that God's goodness isn't predicated on our circumstance. That's not the kind of God we serve. You know, that's what humans' characters are. That's not God's character.
Right. Yeah, I love that. It's so encouraging to my heart. And I love it. It just sets me at ease because I've just been uneven recently in my emotions and in my thoughts. But when I read God's word, when I'm reminded of that, man, and I declare it, I was reminded in my devotions again today, declare God's truth over your life. The feelings are real. We're not saying that you don't feel scared, but we're saying it's ultimately God's truth can prevail and give us something steady to stand on. Not my emotions, not the things around us. And that's really, and we said this on the top before we opened, Ravi Zacharias, who just recently passed away, that the apologetic pastor and speaker, and he really shaped my life and my faith. And that was one of the things he always said, is that your feelings are real, but God's truth has the power to change you and take you to a different place in God, while your feelings can keep you and make you spiral and swirl into self-doubt and worry and shame. So that's just something that I'm reminded. So I appreciate him and his faith in Christ, and it really shaped me.
I don't know about you guys, but Pastor Tommy, when you were talking about that, one of the things that always comes to mind is this idea that truth confronts. And so, you know, in thinking about like what we're dealing with and maybe the emotions that have run rampant because of being isolated, not really having a whole lot of people to talk to, being stuck around the same people all the time, how much more important it is for us to get into the word of God, even if it's just for a couple minutes every single day, just so the truth can confront the root of the problem in our heart. And so like, I think about, we've all in some way addressed anxiety that we might be feeling, and it really at the root of anxiety is it's a selfish problem because we feel like we're not in control of the situation that we're going through, but truth confronts us. And the truth of the gospel is that we no longer have to focus on our own problems, our own insecurities, the control problem that maybe we have, and we get to focus on, I love what you said about declaring that truth over our lives.
Amen. Well, that's all we wanted to share today. And I appreciate you closing that with that thought, Nathan. I think that was inspired, kind of gave us a good landing. So we'll close out. Caleb, do you want to close out in prayer for us? Pray for our students. We usually do prayer on Tuesday, but today we're doing a devotion. We're kicking off something different and new. So would you pray for our students, our churches, and our community during this reentry phase?
Absolutely. God, we thank you so much for this opportunity to come together, Lord, as the church of God, Lord, as the big church, Lord. We're not separated, we're unified, Lord. And although we may have different pastors and different youth groups that we go to, Lord, we all come together to celebrate and spread the same truth of your gospel, Lord. And the gospel simply means this, that you are good, that your son died for us, and he has a hope and future for us, Lord, and that your Holy Spirit lives inside of us. So, Lord, we celebrate that today, Lord. We bring up the things that we just spoke about, Lord, the anxiety, the worry, the fear, the fear of missing out, the fear of the unknown, the fear of what things are going to look like, God. And we just give it all to you right now, Lord. Every person listening to this, Lord, if they're dealing with anxiety, worry, depression, fear, God, will they just feel the peace of your spirit right at this moment as they hear this, God? Will you come in and invade their thoughts and show them who you are? Show them the truth, as Pastor Tommy said, Lord. Show them the truth of your word, the truth of your love, the truth of who you are as our good, good Father, Lord. And that's who you are. You're our Father. You want good things for us, Lord. You have nothing but great things planned for us, Lord. And despite what the world around us looks like, Lord, we hold on to the heavenly hope that you have a future for each and every one of us, Lord, and ultimately our home in heaven with you one day. So we praise you and we thank you for this time together. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you all for joining us. Thank you guys. Love these guys and love doing this with you. Love you guys. Maybe we'll catch you next week. And this is awesome.
See you guys. Peace.
Bye, guys.